is equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. You can be better informed, more motivated, and more effective. Subscribe to our fact-filled newsletter, follow us on Facebook, check out our YouTube channel, listen to our podcasts, and keep up to date with all of our projects at ruthinstitute.org. Father Paul Sullins is once again a guest of Father Rob Jack on Sacred Heart Radio's Driving Home the Faith. They're discussing the tragic problem of clergy sexual abuse and misconduct in the Catholic Church in light of the recent USCCB audit, which is the subject of Father Sullins' latest report.
With us now is Father Paul Sullins, and he is a senior research associate at the Ruth Institute and a recently retired professor of sociology at the Catholic University of America. Father Sullins, thank you for being with us today.
Father Rob, it's a real joy to be with you and all of your listeners this afternoon.
You know, whenever you come on, you always can help make sense out of numbers. And, of course, now last week, the USCCB, United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, and the Lay Review Board released the 2019 report auditing, which describes in terms of maintaining child safety, in terms of the number of abuses that were reported and dealt with. And this year had some rather interesting results, didn't it?
Yes, it was a tsunami of new revelations, more than in any prior year of the audit, more than since the original John Jay report back in 2002. That report made known about 14,800 allegations of clergy sex abuse against minors by Catholic priests from 1950 to 2002. So now think of that number, 14,800. In last year alone, in the 2019 audit report, we learned of an additional 4,434 allegations. So it's about 30% more allegations in 1 year than we found in the shocking report that woke us all up 18 years ago. So the numbers to remember are that number, 4,434. The number of allegations last year, 2018, 1,451, only about a third as many. The year before that, 2017, 693, only less than half as many as the year after that. And in 2016, it was 1,318. In 2015, 903. So what we saw last year was almost a quadrupling of the number of allegations over the past 4 years. We also learned of many new sex abusers last year. Many of the allegations pertain to men who have already been accused in prior years, but a number of them are newly accused men. Last year that was 598. Again, that's more than in any year since, I think, the beginning of the Charter audit reports. And so what we're learning is that this problem of clergy sex abuse is larger than we had even thought before that. We also learned a couple of more disturbing things. One is that each year we learn of certain numbers of allegations that are ongoing. Most of the allegations, 95% of them, concern abuse that happened in the past, sometime the long ago past, and there's concern about dealing with those perpetrators. But we learned about 37 incidents of current ongoing abuse of minors that happened last year in the Catholic Church. That's above the average for the past 4 years, which was 25 incidents. And so that's not many compared to the hundreds of reports in the past, but it's of concern because it's current among us, and it appears maybe to be growing. The National Review Board that comments on the report for the bishops says that the presence of these current allegations reminds us that the problem of clergy sex abuse is not something in the past, but it's something present among us in the church. Now, I want to give you one piece of good news and then a piece of bad news. The piece of good news is that the majority of the victims in the past decade have not been boys, they've been girls. We've moved from kind of a homosexual-oriented predation to more male-on-female abuse. And you may say that's good news. That, why is that good news? Because male and female abuse is much less prevalent, much less common. There's always been a certain amount of that. That amount seems not to have gone up. So what we're seeing in the decline and then the increase and continuation of abuse is a switch from homosexual or same-sex attracted, we could say, perpetrators to heterosexual perpetrators. But last year we saw many, many more such perpetrators than in prior years. Each year they permanently remove priests from ministry who have been not only accused but have been convicted or found to be credibly abused in some manner. The average number that were removed from 2010 to 2018 was about 25 to 27 priests. Last year, they permanently removed from ministry 142 priests. They're actually priests and a few deacons, but mostly priests. And so we see a huge jump up in the prevalence and in the seriousness of the sex abuse that's been reported. Now, the reason for this is because many states have relaxed their statutes of limitations laws. Some dioceses have established victims' compensation funds to encourage victims to come forward. So we have all of those things going on that are encouraging more reports. Nonetheless, what we're finding is that what we've been told each year in the audit report about the rate and the prevalence of abuse has really been understating the extent of the problem. So overall, it's not good news.
We're speaking here with Father Paul Sullins, who is a research associate at the Ruth Institute, about the USCC report that just came out, which shows an increase in the reporting of child sexual abuse. Father Sullins, a question I have is that the priests who have been, shall we say, accused or credibly accused, how many of them have been ordained in the last 20 years?
Not many. That's a great question. And I'm going to address this and other questions like that this weekend at a conference at the Ruth Institute. It's called the Summit for the Survivors of the Sexual Revolution, but on Saturday I'm going to be talking about this. And we have a report that's been printed or, I guess, I want to say promulgated. That's a theological type word, right?
Yeah.
It's been published on the Ruth Institute website, and your listeners can just Google Clergy Sex Abuse 2020 and then Ruth Institute or my name, which is Sullins, and they can get that report. But what I show is that in the past 20 years, most of the very little abuse, almost none of the abuse, has been by men recently ordained. It has been by men that have been ordained 10 years or longer. And that's exactly the opposite of the case that occurred in the 1980s, when the large majority of the abuse was by recently ordained priests. So that's a piece of good news, Father Rob, that we have not been ordaining so many homosexual men. I can show all of the statistical estimates of that in the reports that people can get from the Ruth Institute. We have a wave of younger faithful priests that have come in. They're not engaging in much abuse at all. Not none. I wish I could say none, but not much at all. Most of the abuse is by older men, I have to say.
Well, you know, I asked that, Father, for specific reason. I taught in the seminary for 18 years, and one of the things I've noticed over about the last, I'd say 15 years or so, was really the psychological and, lack of a better word, psychosexual maturity of these young men, that in many ways they parallel the millennials in terms of having good, healthy human relationships and knowing how to interact, and it was basically acknowledged. And also, I remember during the time time when 2002, you know, hit, and then the seminary, they really upped the teaching on priestly celibacy, and they really tried to be very, very clear on that. And as usual, when you get away from those things tend to drop off. Faculty changes and other things tend to kind of lose this vision. And that was the main reason I was asking, because I just know from my own personal experience that many of the men coming into the seminary aren't even at the point of really having the mature level, even in the psychological testing. And unfortunately, I also know for a fact that dioceses were desperate. We need priests. And so oftentimes, if there are issues, those issues might get overlooked, or they might delay someone for ordination by 6 months to see what's going to happen. But in the end, they get ordained. And I honestly worry that as these guys go through maturity, that we might not have some more problems. Or what concerns me is the number of men leaving the priesthood after only being in 2 or 3 years.
Right. What you're saying is strongly confirmed by a look at the data that I provided in the reports, where we have surveys where priests report their level of agreement with the teaching of the church and their sexual orientation. And what I found was that we turned a corner along about 2000, where priests started getting much more faithful. We had much less homosexual orientation and much more heterosexual orientation, faithful young men that came in along about that time. So we have a new wave, which is what I call it, of priests coming in. In the future, I think time is on our side. I've estimated that about 25% of priests today that are over the age of 65 are homosexual. And that cohort is going to, we say, age out of the priest population, and they'll be replaced by priests that the priests age 50 and under today, less than 2% of those, by my estimates, are homosexual. Being a homosexual priest correlates strongly with priests who are not able to maintain celibacy as well, don't agree with or affirm the teaching of the church in key areas as much. I wouldn't say that there's a stark distinction between the two groups of priests, but there are average tendencies.
With us now is Father Paul Sullins as we continue our discussion on the 2019 annual report of the Catholic bishops regarding child safety. And the numbers are up quite a bit. And, Father Sullins, you say there's still, though, a reason for hope.
Yes, there's lots of reason for hope. The existence of this report is one of the reasons for hope. It was established by the bishops to kind of hold their feet to the fire, to help us to know and understand the extent of the problem. Now, it's not a perfect process, but it is really a great process. In this country, we have voluntary tax compliance. We're all going to be paying our taxes if we haven't done so already in a couple of days. And we have random audits. Nobody likes to get an audit, but the random audits of taxes helps to encourage compliance. Audits don't hurt honest people, at least theoretically, but they're designed to weed out cheaters. And so the good news is that most dioceses have done a really great job in addressing child sex abuse and in creating what they call a culture of safety. The bad news is that some have not. Since the beginning of the audit, the National Review Board has put its finger on one weakness in the audit system, and that is that we have required audits under the charter of every Catholic diocese, and we have close to 100% cooperation from the dioceses in that. But there's no requirement for parishes to be audited. For a diocese to go and visit a parish or to sit down and review their records and see if they are training their children or training their volunteers or doing the background checks they should be doing, and so on and so forth. The good news is that 60% of dioceses do engage in some form of parish audit on their own voluntarily. The bad news is that 40% do not. And those percentages haven't changed for almost a decade. And so one of the strong recommendations made by the NRB in this report is that we insist on parish audits. It says until every diocese implements parish audits, it's difficult to conclude that a diocese has indeed established a culture of safety. Now, one of the weaknesses of the audit reports is they don't tell us which dioceses have and which haven't. Everything in these reports are reported in national percentages. It doesn't identify any dioceses at all. So one thing people can do is to go to their diocesan leaders or go to their bishop and say, are we doing parish audits? Most dioceses are. We'd like to be on the side of those dioceses. Because, you know, sexual abuse happens by people who want to pull the wool over the eyes of those who might see them. They are pretty good. Some of these predators are good at grooming parishes, even, to overlook their misbehavior and ingratiating themselves and fudging things up. So that's one thing that we can do that has been recommended for many years in order to improve the culture of safety in our dioceses.
Well, Father Sullins, I know coming up this weekend is the Ruth Institute's 2020 Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution on this coming Saturday, and it's going to be online for virtual passes. And this is where I guess some of your research is going to be made known, huh?
Yes, I'll present all my research. It includes what I've talked about here today, but many, many other aspects, not only of clergy sexual abuse, but also some of the other myths of the sexual revolution that have to do with distress following abortion for women and have to do with the benefit of two parents, a man and a woman, two parents for children.
And just for the information of our listeners, virtual passes for this conference are available for $30, and the watch party passes for $75, and they can sign up at theruthinstitute.org to watch your presentation and the presentation of, I guess, a few other speakers that day.
Yes, we have a wonderful range of speakers.
Well, Father Sullins, thank you so much for giving us this information today. And it is, it's a mixed message, obviously. I mean, there's some good news and some bad news. But one thing I've between what you have read and I read an interesting article on crisismagazine.org about the same thing. And that is, the question is, you know, what will restore our trust of the bishops? And the answer that was given by some is an increased transparency and to continue to make known these numbers and do what they can in formation to make sure that these kind of men don't get ordained.
Right. Exactly.
Well, I hope you have a wonderful day, and I pray that on Saturday you have a great conference. I know our own Gail Finke will be down there, and so you'll get to meet her, and she'll probably have a lot more questions for you. She always writes a lot of questions for me. I can usually only scratch the surface.
Wonderful. Great. I'm looking forward to it. Thank you, Father Rob.
You're welcome. We'll also put up on our show notes the address and everything if people want to sign up for this this institute on this Saturday at theruthinstitute.org.
You've just been listening to Father Paul Sullins and Father Rob Jack discussing the tragic problem of clergy sex abuse and misconduct in the Catholic Church in light of the recent USCCB audit. This audit is the subject of Father Sullins' latest report, linked on our website and in the show notes. This podcast is a rebroadcast of a segment of Sacred Heart Radio's Driving Home the Faith. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. Like us on Facebook, check out the site, and subscribe to our weekly newsletter to stay informed.